men found, found Irish men found work on the road crews, as well as all the other digging projects. Eventually, the Irish began working in the mills, and of course, the top mill there is the Bates Mill. It was completed in 1850, or the first part was completed in 1852. Below and to the left is the Androscoggin Mill, built in 1860 in anticipation of the Civil War. And when you think about where that mill is located, it's sandwiched between the Gas House Patch, Burnt Woods, and Strawberry Patch, and that section on Lisbon Street called West Rose Hill, which was a heavily Irish neighborhood as well. It was right smack in much of that neighborhood grew up around the mill itself. And off to the right, the little one is the Lewiston Bleachery and Dye Works building. And this was, the bleachery was a little bit different from most of the mills. Most of the mills were two-thirds to three-quarters female operatives. The bleachery was about reverse proportion male. It was the most male of the mills, which is interesting to note. And what else? And it was heavily populated with Irishmen. There were, as you look through the city directories, you'll see a fair number of people listed as working in the bleachery. Okay, schools. I'm not sure it was fair to put Father Wallace up there again, but I didn't have any other good slides. But the school, there's some interesting facets to the Lewiston and Auburn school systems and the Irish participation there. Of course, Father Wallace came to Lewiston and was assigned to St. Joseph's in 1876. By 1880, he was elected to the school board. The public school board, and him being there, he got other people involved in the school board as well. And Father Wallace began St. Joseph's School, he began St. Patrick's School, and one of the things yet to research about him is his role in the rest of the public schools. And there was, of course, one public school named after him on Main Street. But it wasn't just Father Wallace, certainly not by any stretch. One of the neat things I ran across was the Lewiston Normal Training School. And this was an institution begun in the schools where the existed on the site of the current Dingley building in the Lewiston School Department. And in 1869, they decided to start a program there to train Lewiston's teachers. And amongst the students, and there's they're listed out amongst the students listed were a fair number of Irish women. Margaret O'Donnell, who I believe was the daughter of say it's Thomas. No, Thomas is somebody else. Patrick O'Donnell. Patrick O'Donnell was one of the contractors for the canals. And Margaret she completed the program at the training school. You all know what a normal training school is, right? Yeah, sort of like University of Southern Maine started as a teacher's college. What else did Farmington started that way. I know there was one in Castine at one point.
Yeah, it was called Farmington Normal School before.
Was it? Okay. So Lewiston had its own training academy for its teachers. Margaret graduated from that program in 1873 and taught only for a couple of years because she got married, or she was married, to a guy named Timothy Murphy, who ran a fur and men's furnishings business. And you all, even today, still remember this. It was a multi-generational business, and it began, I believe, in 1872 on Lisbon Street, eventually moved into the McGillicuddy, first McGillicuddy block on the basement.
but he married Margaret O'Donnell, so she, and the rule in those days was, you know, when you got married, you stopped teaching.
Absolutely.
Without question, right? Not one more day of teaching, right? Well, let's see, what else do we know about the teachers? Yeah, Mary H. Wellahan was another name I found in there, so the Wellahans. I had somebody going through the school there. And a bunch of others. Now, which is interesting, and it's interesting to see that they went through there, because it's a little bit different than how, you know, when the French Canadian population came to Lewiston and Auburn, they tended to stick with their own schools, you know, start their own parochial schools, and they would send their kids to Canada for the boarding schools. Whereas the Irish tended more to they certainly started their schools, but tended more to go into the public schools. And apparently, you know, I suspect that Father Wallace was influential. You know, him being on the school board, you know, this is just one of those things that I suspect he probably helped recruit folks to attend that school and take up the teaching profession, get involved. Of schools that they went to. Looking at where those teachers were assigned and judging only on that, there was a school on Bates Street. The building is still there. It's down towards just past the Episcopal Church. And a number of these, you know, Irish surname.
Coburn School.
Okay, yeah. And the directory is, I believe, was called the Bates Street School at some point. Yeah. There seemed to be a fair number of these Irish surname teachers going to that school, and looking at an old map, there were most of the buildings around that school have Irish names, you know, noted on the houses as well. So there was a cluster of a neighborhood there, so I suspect there were a fair number of Irish kids going to that school. Also down by a gas house patch, there's a fire station down there on the opposite corner, opposite the store. It's now a home, somebody's home, but there used to be two school buildings on that lot, on that corner as well, and that's another place that a number of these teachers went to, you know, Irish surname teachers served in. Now, as I went through doing my genealogy, I kept running across some of the same names on the birth and death certificates, and John Donovan was probably the first Irish doctor here, and he came here in about 1866, and he was originally from Holton, went to medical school in New York, and then found his way to Lewiston, Maine. And that's where he spent the rest of his life. His first wife, Jane, Jane died in 1908, and he remarried Kate Joyce. And Kate was also a graduate of the Lewiston Normal Training School, so she was a teacher. And Dr. Donovan died in 1919. So he was on the scene here for 40 some odd years. Yeah. And another name I ran across, perhaps because of the timing of my family, the people I was looking at, was John Leader. Dr. John Leader died fairly young. He died in 1900 at the age of 35. Mm-hmm. He did get his name out there. His name's on a lot of certificates. And family connection for me is Jerome Murphy. And some of you probably remember Dr. Murphy.
Yeah.
Yep, it was
E. Jerome.
E. Jerome, yep, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know,
talking with my grandmother was great, and I really got a sense that there was an Irish community. And I think this is the memory I was drawing on. You know, E. Jerome was her doctor. She was, and E. Jerome was her cousin. And the priest that married both her and her daughter, maybe more than one of them, was another cousin. And one of the lawyers, her lawyer, or sometimes lawyer, was somebody in the family as well. So you can see, and like I said, when you look at the birth and death certificates, you know, you see the same name over and over and over again. It's pretty apparent that there's a, you know, a distinct community, Irish community there. And my favorite story, or one of my favorite stories that my grandmother told me about E. Jerome, Dr. Murphy, has to do with my parents' wedding. And understand that my mother was an Auburn girl, my father was an Oxford County country boy, and you know, I remember on trips that we used to take, long trips, he would sometimes pull over, run off into the woods for a minute, come back, and me being, you know, knee-high, well, where did you go, Dad? Where did you go? And he would always say, went to see a man about a horse. So keep that in mind. So at my parents' wedding, my father's mother, you know, country girl, Yankee stock, you know, from limited means, but a very intelligent woman. She didn't get her high school degree until she was better than 50. It might have been closer to 60. A very intelligent woman, reporter for the Sun Journal at one point, was socializing. I'm sure that they had all been celebrating. That she was went up to Dr. Murphy, introduced herself and whatnot, and asked him, well, what do you do? And, Dr. Murphy says, well, I'm a doctor. Now, for most people, that would be enough. Graham had to ask, well, what kind of doctor? And he answered, well, a horse doctor. And he wasn't lying. He was actually the track physician for Scarborough Downs. But it amused her, and the telling, my grandmother always enjoyed telling the story. So, I can just imagine all of them. But so as you all do your research or what have you, again, you'll probably encounter the same names. It'll just be something to look at as you look at records. Lewiston was blessed with quite a number of Irish lawyers. Dennis J. Callahan was born in Ireland. He had two brothers that we'll talk about on Thursday who had a store on Lewiston Street. But Dennis was a lawyer. At one point he was a city solicitor. He was on the school committee and was also superintendent of schools in Lewiston. Daniel John McGillicuddy, D.J. McGillicuddy, is a big name. This is somebody whose story needs to be told. He was a successful lawyer in his father's building at the corner of Ash and Lisbon Street. And D.J. was the first Irish mayor of Lewiston, and I believe the state as well. I haven't found anybody in any other Irish mayors before him. One in Portland will claim to be Irish, but they're really Scotch-Irish. And I'm sorry, McClellan is a Scottish name, I'm sorry. No offense to the Scots, but the McClellans were only in Ireland for 100 years, so. Or at least that branch. John, let's see, D.J. McGillicuddy served three terms, actually, as mayor. And not consecutively, but three terms. From the late 1880s into the early 1900s. I think his third term was in 1902. And then he ran for U.S. House of Representatives in 06 and 08, losing. But then in 1910, he won and served three terms as the U.S. Representative from this district. So he's a significant individual that you just don't hear about when you talk about Lewiston and Auburn. And so John D. Clifford and William H. Clifford were sons of John D. Clifford Sr. And they went on to illustrious careers.
John D. Clifford Jr.